So this is the 2017 MacBook Pro, and not a lot has changed from previous models in terms of design, but we have upgraded processors and faster speeds. So is the 2017 MacBook worth it? Let's find out. Starting with the unboxing, the packaging is very compact and a pleasure to unbox. Inside the box, we are introduced with the laptop itself. I got a 13-inch base model with touch bar, and this is the cheapest MacBook Pro you can get with touch bar. But other than that, we have a USB-C charging cable, some paperwork, some Apple stickers and all that, and lastly our power brick. But unfortunately, Apple no longer includes an extension cable. So back to the laptop, the design is exactly the same from the 2016 model and a little bit different from the older models. We have a mirror design Apple logo instead of the glowing one, which I really like, but once you get used to this one, the old logo looks a little old school. For colors, we have space gray, which I have right over here, which is just a darker version of classic silver, which is our second option in terms of colors for the MacBook Pro. The trackpad is a lot larger comparing to 2015 models, but honestly, I really like the large looking trackpad. It looks really good just by itself, but I heard some people were having issues where if they rest their hand on the trackpad and they accidentally end up pressing or moving the mouse. But for me, I didn't face any problems like that. The trackpad does a great job differentiating my fingers and the rest of my hand. And before we move to the keyboard, I also want to mention we have upgraded hinges now. Where they used to be plastic before and took a lot more space, now the hinges are full metal and is part of the top screen. Moving forward, for our keyboard we have second generation butterfly keys. Coming from an older MacBook, I like how the keys are a little bit bigger now, but that kind of changes the entire layout, so I'm still getting used to that. And the other thing is, the keys have little to no travel. So you just don't get that feedback while typing, and since the keys don't have a lot of travel, that means they're almost flush to the surface. And as I said, the keys are a little bit bigger now, which also means there's less space between the keys. So that kind of messes up with your typing. You'll have to get used to that, and I often have to look down to see what I'm pressing. And I'm a little more likely to make mistakes by accidentally pressing the wrong key. Honestly, I really liked the old keys. They had a good amount of travel and I was pretty comfortable with them, but maybe over time I'll get used to this as well. We'll see. But overall for design, it's the same body, just a little bit slimmer with some minor tweaks that differentiate it and make it look more futuristic. But still, it's probably the best designed laptop for 2017. And right above our keyboard we have the touch bar, which is a love it or hate it kind of thing. And so far, I don't like it so much in terms of functionality. Sure, it looks different, quite appealing, and depending on what you do, you might find it a little useful. Like, it gives you automatic suggestions, so you save some time there if you actually get in the habit of looking down while typing. And other places like switching around tab, going through your pictures, and all that. But in terms of functionality, I prefer physical keys a lot more. For instance, I loaded Windows on this Mac and I wanted to boot up in safe mode, which is usually Shift plus F8. But I can't do that on this computer because the touch bar doesn't start working until the entire operating system is up and running. So I needed an external keyboard just to command Shift plus F8. Also, things like playing music is as simple as pressing a button on the previous computers. But here, it's a two-step process. For editing, I tried my best to use the touch bar as much as I can, and everything works fine, but it's way better to use your keyboard and your mouse instead. So overall, it's a good looking fancy little toy, but nothing as practical as an actual keyboard. But this could also totally depend on what you're doing on your computer. If you don't do any professional work, the touch bar should be pretty enjoyable for you. And moving on, the base model I have with touch bar, the specs are as follow. Performance wise, works really good doing everyday tasks. I use it for video editing, Final Cut, and it worked all okay, but there were times where I saw the spinning wheel and some freeze points. So if you're looking to do heavy work, I suggest you stay away from the base model. The base model is good, but in terms of performance, it's more like a MacBook Air. For instance, my 2013 MacBook Pro got better multi-score in Geekbench, and I definitely feel my older computer is much faster while editing videos. And I don't mean to say the new computers aren't good, but if you need it for high intensive work, I recommend you upgrade your processor and even your RAM if you need to. I also installed Windows 10 here, which if you're interested in, I will have the video linked in a card. But I installed GTA, and playing the game at maxed out graphics, I was getting somewhere around 18 to 20 frames per second. Playing in normal setting, I was getting a solid 30 frames per second. But yeah, Macs aren't really made for gaming, but if you want to, once in a while, you'll at least know what the performance looks like. In terms of battery life, Apple claims up to 10 hours, but depending on what you're doing, that can truly affect your battery life. But just to give you guys an idea, I will be editing this entire video on this computer, starting with full battery life, and by the end, I'll write down the time it took to finish the video and how much battery I was left with. And then I'll re-export the video so you guys can see that information on your screen. In terms of port, we all know Apple killed everything and now we're just left with 4 Thunderbolt 3 ports where any one of them can be used for charging using USB 3, which is great, but after buying such an expensive laptop, you'll probably need to spend an extra $100 in a USB hub, just so you can connect all your SD cards and memory sticks. I also really missed the MagSafe connectors, which had magnets and a LED light so you know if your laptop's charging or not. But yeah, overall the MacBook Pro base model has its pros and cons, and depending on who you are, it might be a good choice for you. If you're a student who needs something lightweight, good performance, and good battery life. But if you're someone who needs a machine for more professional work like video editing or other high intensive work, I suggest you stay away from the base model and get an upgraded processor and an upgraded RAM if you need that. And if you have the 2016 model, there's not a big performance difference that will make you upgrade. But if you have something older and feel the need to upgrade, the MacBook Pro is definitely worth considering. Let me know your thoughts about this in a comment down below and subscribe for more content if you haven't already. And as always, thanks for watching.